welcome you to the winter installment of the Westmont Reading Series. We've had many a fine writer in the series, and tonight we're privileged to have Sara Zarr, a wonderful young adult novelist. You know, about 32 years ago, Sara Zarr first came to Westmont with her mother and her older sister, who was starting as a freshman, and Sara was 14 years old at the time, and now she's back. I don't know if things look differently or not to her, but we're glad to have you back, Sara. As I was thinking about Sara Zarr's work as a young adult novelist, I was thinking actually about Wendell Berry, and Sara Zarr writes nothing like Wendell Berry, actually. But I was thinking of the last time I heard Wendell Berry speak at UCSB, and he gave a wonderful reading, and there was a Q&A session, as we'll have tonight. We'll go about an hour. Sara will read about 40 minutes, and we'll do about 20 minutes of Q&A, and then there's books for sale, and she'll sign them for you. But in this Q&A with Wendell Berry at UCSB, a woman raised her hand and said, "Mr. Berry, do you think we should teach gardening in the schools?" You know, and she obviously thought this was a really fat pitch that he was going to hit out of the park. And Wendell Berry said, "I think we should teach Homer and Shakespeare and the Bible in school and teach gardening after school." And then he went on to speak more eloquently than I can about the value of literature and of the writers who have gone before us. And he put it this way: we're always in trouble. We always find ourselves in these predicaments as human beings. And we tell ourselves that no one has ever been in this kind of trouble before, that we are unique, but we are not. And others have been in trouble before us and left their witness, and in many cases a literary witness, and that's something in which we can take solace. So I think of that story because when I think of your work, Sara, I think of 15, 16-year-old girls in trouble, in a heap of trouble. Whether it's the trouble of being abandoned or seduced or assaulted or kidnapped or just sort of ignored. Sara Zarr is very sensitive to that, and you don't have to have been a 16-year-old girl to enter into that trouble and to take some comfort in it and to take some comfort in just a hint of redemption that can come in the midst of that trouble. Sara is the author of 6 young adult novels thus far, and a 7th, Jem and Dixie, coming out in April. Her first novel, Story of a Girl, was published just 10 years ago in 2007. It's actually the 4th novel she ever wrote, but the first that was published, and this novel became a finalist for the National Book Award. Subsequent titles are Sweethearts, Once Was Lost, How to Save a Life, The Lucy Variations, Roomies, and then, as I said, Jem and Dixie, coming out in April. And 4 of these titles are on sale for you right outside the door. Sara Zarr grew up in San Francisco, attended San Francisco State University, has lived with her husband in Salt Lake City for the last 16 years. She was sharing with some of the faculty at lunch that Madeleine L'Engle's book, Walking on Water, a book about art and faith, was pivotal for her in coming to an understanding of herself and her craft as a writer who is also a person of faith. And Sara was asked to write a new introduction for Madeleine L'Engle's book, just recently and shared that with us. And that leads me to my last impression. Shortly before Madeleine L'Engle passed away, she made a visit to Westmont, and I had the privilege of having her down in Reynolds Hall and showing her our C.S. Lewis wardrobe. And she sort of stepped back, and it's a big smile crossed her face. And I had the same experience yesterday with Sara Zarr. So someday I'll be able to say that I've met both of them. And they never met one another, so, you know, I'm the important link here. Anyway, Sara, come on up. We're so glad you're here.
Thanks, Paul, for that introduction, my third introduction by Paul today. And I know a lot of you have already heard me talk and read today, so I'm going to try and say different things and read different things. But there might be a little bit of repetition. I met Paul Willis a couple years ago when we were both being inducted into a secret society. And he took me on, he's like, hey, we were outside the area where the society was voting on whether or not we could be members. And this is a true story. And Paul was like, do you want to go for a hike or something while this goes on? We're like, all right. So I went hiking with Paul, which I think that's his way to connect with people probably, is take them for a walk. But I'm happy that it has led me here today. I don't really have a formal way of going about all of this. Like, I'll have little notes to myself that say, introduce myself and my background. When I decided to try to be a writer, learning by doing. This is weird, like, I don't know how I was gonna talk about this, but it just says, knowing who I am as a writer and not trying to be a different writer out of fear of being irrelevant. So I was having some fears of being irrelevant when I was taking notes for this. Maybe a lot of you heard today kind of my backstory of like how I got started writing and what that kind of process was like. So maybe I'll just go right into what I write about and why I think I write about those things. I think people who know me, and I think you can tell if you've talked to me, that I'm not a sad, depressed, droopy, gloomy person. Like, I like to laugh, and humor is my main way of interacting with just day-to-day stuff. But my books are kind of serious, and not a lot of that humor comes through. Occasionally it does, but typically my books are pretty serious, and I think part of that has to do with my influences. Madeleine L'Engle was one. I was never a huge fan, actually, of The Wrinkle in Time first set of books, but the sort of next round of stuff she did with the second generation of those kids and the Austin Family Chronicles and stuff like that, I loved those. And then she wrote a few like standalone novels with older characters that I really liked. But she always approached the lives of teenage characters with a lot of respect and seriousness. Not melodramatically overwrought, but just a respect that the lives and experiences of adolescent characters were interesting and they were valuable and complicated, and that their problems were real, and especially for girls. And being kind of like a smart kid who just wanted to read a lot and hang out with adults, I liked how her characters were like that. They liked to read and they liked to talk to adults. So she's one influence. Another was Robert Cormier, who wrote one of the novels that was at the forefront of what became the canon of young adult literature in that first wave of the late 60s, early to mid 70s. It was a book called The Chocolate War, which you may have read in high school or junior high or maybe after. And his books are like so dark and depressing. None of them end on a happy note, I don't think. And a lot of teachers that, you know, he would win awards and things and his books would end up on lists, and a lot of teachers that would teach them, they would might get feedback from parents of just like, why are you making my child read this depressing story about terrible people? But I loved his books because I felt like, similar to the way I felt about Lengel's work, even though hers was so different, was that he treated the problems and the lives and experiences of teenage characters as interesting and as mattering. And it's funny, one of the kind of common insults that you hear tossed around out in the world, well, I heard it said about Trump like a week or two ago, someone accused him of acting like a teenage girl. And it's a handy insult that people use, you know, don't be such a girl, or you're acting like a teenage girl. And it's interesting. Why do we do that? Why do we say those things when the lives of teenage girls are as valuable as anyone else's? And, you know, like Paul said, you don't have to have been a 16-year-old girl, but half the people have been. So I think my recurring, that's something I think that, that influence on my work of just like, I take that period of life seriously. I felt serious about it when I was in it. When I was 16, I fell in love with the man that I had been married to for 26 years. So I mean, that's a big thing to happen to one of these like silly teenage girls. So that's a recurring thing that comes through. And another thing is characters, as Paul mentioned, or I'm probably supposed to refer to you as Dr. Willis. No, okay. Characters who have been abandoned in some way. Either a parental kind of obvious abandonment by a parent being absent, or just kind of not paying attention, or even just in more subtle ways, not being there for the teen in a moment where they really need a parent. And that's directly, you know, comes from my experience. My father came from a long line of alcoholic fathers who abandoned their families. It's something that gets passed down. He left when I was maybe 10, almost 11. And then my mom almost immediately remarried. So there was this weird double abandonment where my dad left and then my mom fell in love. And for, you know, a good 4 or 5 years, she was just really into her husband. And then I met my husband and then like my adolescence was over. So like my whole kind of age, well, really going back to age when you first start really becoming aware of stuff in your family, maybe 7 or 8. I mean, I think younger than that, you have a lot of intuition about it. But at 7 or 8 or 9, you start to put it together in a more specific way. And so, yeah, it was just that kind of having to become your own parent in a way. And just so a lot of my characters are in the midst of some kind of crisis or trouble. And they don't have the support that they need necessarily. And then how are they gonna get through that? And how do they ask for help? And who do they ask for help? What kind of other kind of families can they build around them to solve that problem of the missing family? Maybe since I'm talking about that, maybe I'll start with the new book, Jem and Dixie. Which is probably the most directly about parental abandonment of any of my books. This book is about sisters whose names, as you might have guessed, are Jem and Dixie. It's written from the point of view of the older sister, Jem, and there's just a lot going on in their family, and around the midpoint of the book, something happens that creates an opportunity for them to make a choice. I'm not going to say too much. It's one of those that kind of has like a plot twist, but it's not really, because it might just be on the back. They find a bag of money, okay? I mean, I don't know what to tell you. So in this scene, this is kind of a flashback where Jem has just, there's a few chapters that kind of set up Jem and Dixie's relationship. Jem is kind of the caretaker as the older sister, and Dixie's like the younger, a little bit more carefree kid who doesn't quite get what's going on with their parents, and Jem feels like she has to protect her from it. And so this just follows a scene where their dad has written Dixie a letter saying that he's gonna be back in town, but he didn't send, it wasn't to Jem and Dixie, it was only to Dixie, and he didn't communicate at all with Jem. And so now Jem is remembering kind of the last time that their dad left for good. I'm feeling all of a sudden like I might cry. We'll see. The time Mom kicked Dad out for good, Uncle Ivan, Mom's little brother, came to Seattle to help make sure it happened. Ivan's friend Greg was there too, in case Dad didn't want to cooperate and they needed more muscle. They packed up Dad's clothes and things while Dixie and I were at school, and when we got home, everything was in one big pile. Greg's back was to us while he filled a water glass from the kitchen tap. All I remember about him is the back of his head in that moment, bushy red hair around a tiny bald spot that maybe he didn't know about. "Take Dixie into your room and do your homework," Mom said. I looked at the pile, the edges of jeans and the corners of t-shirts and the small wooden box that I knew was full of guitar picks and ticket stubs from all the shows he'd been to. You could see the corner of it from under his beat-up leather jacket. Dixie also spotted it. "That's Dad's special box," she said, as if only then realizing that the whole pile was Dad's and what it meant, that after all the warnings, this was really happening. Mom nodded and wiped at her face like there were tears there, and Dixie went and put her arm around Mom's waist. Mom said, "Jem, I asked you to take her, okay?" Oh, the cat's name is Ringo Starr. Otherwise, this sentence will make no sense. She pushed Ringo Starr away with her foot. Not gently. Uncle Ivan leaned against the wall with the tips of his fingers in his pockets, watching. In our room, I sat on my bed and got out my homework, and Dixie lay on hers and cried. At first, I tried comforting her. I said it would be okay. "No, it won't," she said. I tried once more, and she wouldn't answer. I went to her bed and patted her back. That had worked when she was little. She would feel sad or upset, and I would try to make her feel better. Like when she didn't get invited to a certain birthday party in second grade, or the time she lost her favorite doll on the bus. This time, she shoved me away, and I stood up, finally angry, and said, "She told him this would happen." "You don't even care." He's the one who doesn't care. If he did, he'd stop. I didn't have to explain what I meant by stop, just stop. Dixie sat up. Even with her face red and streaky and with mashed down hair, she looked like a girl crying on TV. You wanted to put your arm around her. I wanted to. "She can't kick him out," Dixie said. "It's his apartment too." "Then he should come home at night. He shouldn't have a girlfriend. He should have a job and help pay the rent." She pulled a pillow over her face and rocked. "You can cry if you want," I said, "but I have to do my homework." I turned my back on her. "I hate you." Those words coming from Dixie should have stopped meaning much to me, but they always hurt. I sat on my bed and worked on a math problem. Eventually, Dixie fell asleep, and I went out into the hall to watch Ivan and Greg and Mom sit around the table, waiting, one or the other of them occasionally whispering something into the smoky room. They'd put Dad's stuff into boxes that someone must have gone down to the liquor store to get, and the boxes stood in a tower by the door. I scooted closer to the edge of the light and pulled my big sweatshirt over my knees. Mostly, I watched Uncle Ivan. He looked a lot like Mom, only with dark hair, almost black, and hazel eyes instead of blue. He got more of the Greek-looking genes than Mom did. There was something about the way he brought his cigarette to his lips, a kind of confident and definite way, the tendons of his hands flexing, that made me wish he was there all the time. He sensed me in the hall, glanced over, then pushed his chair away from the table. He came and stood over me, his half-smoked cigarette between his fingers. You should probably go to bed. I squashed myself down into the carpet harder and shook my head. He crouched down with his back against the wall. Jem, you know what? I think this is something you shouldn't see. I think, how old are you?
14.
14, he said, incredulous. That happened fast. He took a drag from his cigarette and looked toward where Mom sat. I think this is something you don't want to have in your head for the rest of your life. Already I had the tower of boxes, Dixie's crying face, all the fights and everything else that had come before. I didn't move. What if it's the last time I see him? I whispered. He put his hand on the back of my head and smoothed my hair. Yeah, what if it is? You'll be all right. I looked at his profile to see if he meant it or if he was saying it to me, just like I had to Dixie, that it would be okay, because how could either of us know? A little of his ash had fallen on the carpet. He rubbed it in with his thumb until it disappeared. If it is the last time, you don't want this to be how you remember him, okay? You're gonna have enough shit to shovel your way out of down the line. Trust me, I know. Ivan. Mom had gone to stand by the window. Now she turned and gestured. I think that's him down on the street. Uncle Ivan squeezed my neck, and when he stood, I did too, and went to our room. I made kissing noises so that Ringo would follow me and close the door. But still, I listened, with my ear pressed to it. In the end, Dad went quietly. He must have seen Greg and Ivan and all his stuff piled up and known there'd be no point in pushing back. I listened for my name, for him to say my name, or Dixie's, for him to ask to say goodbye to us, demand it. I listened even as I went back to my bed, listened until I fell asleep, and when I got up in the morning, the tower of boxes and my dad were gone. Uncle Ivan was gone too, back to his job and his life in Idaho. Mom and Ivan hadn't found all Dad's things though. A few days later, I was looking for food and saw up on the high shelf in the kitchen a box marked wedding stuff. I wanted to see what kind of wedding stuff my parents had, but the box was full of cigarettes, cartons of them. A brand from Mexico called Hacienda, with a man in a red serape under a yellow sun on each pack. I took the box to my room and put it under my bed. Though I guess they were Dad's, they made me think of Uncle Ivan and how he'd sat with me in the hall and smoothed my hair, smoke curling around us. I started carrying a pack of the cigarettes in my jacket pocket. Whenever I needed to, like when I felt anxious or alone, I reached into my pocket and felt for the light cellophane-wrapped rectangle, its exact corners and slick surface. I'd study the packaging. Hacienda. I thought it meant something like home. If I stared at the man in the serape long enough, I could imagine those were Uncle Ivan's eyes squinting under the sun, looking right at me, whispering the word in Spanish. Now, this is an example for those of you in the creative writing class who wonder about maybe how to take personal experiences and use them in fiction, but not make them exactly like they were. This scene developed because mostly of a memory I had of when my dad left. One day I opened our apartment in San Francisco had a thing in the kitchen where you open the door and the ironing board was in there, and there was like a little shelf up there, and my dad had left behind like a carton of Pall Mall cigarettes. And I took a pack and I went into my bedroom closet and I tried to smoke one. and it was just a weird like impulse to want to feel closer to him, and like this was a thing he had left behind, and I so identified him with a cigarette. I mean, it was terrible. Like, I had childhood asthma because of his smoking, but there was still something, you know, he would sit at the table, and sometimes if he would sometimes roll his own cigarettes, but his brand when he bought packs were Pall Mall, and I just like stole that pack, and I had it for years after that, because I smoked the one, and then I picked up smoking later in junior high, but that was a different thing with my friend's dad's Camels. Jennifer Archer, that's one of my, a friend from high school came here. So that's just an example of like, it's not even really close to my own memory or experience, but just the thing, having an object, you know, when you're writing and you're trying to externalize an emotion or like have an object or a symbol that means something to the character and can mean something to you as the reader, and then of course it comes back, you know, there's like several other times the existence of the cigarettes comes back through the story. So that's the kind of fun romp you're in for when you read my books. Another thing that a lot of my characters are going through is a kind of a crisis of faith. I think adolescence is itself a crisis of faith. You know, not necessarily in religious faith, but it's a crisis of faith in what, it can be a crisis of faith in what you've understood your family to be. Because that job of adolescence is moving from childhood to adulthood. And in childhood, by necessity, and hopefully if you have good people around you, you just, your job as a kid is to trust the adults around you and kind of agree with them and share beliefs. And then as you get into adolescence, your job is to not do that, you know, to like detach from that and figure out, well, what do you think? You know, do you want to think like your parents and vote like your parents and pray like your parents? And then also that's also an age where you start to see some of your parents' more serious flaws in a more real light as you just gain an understanding of, you know, the kinds of problems your parents might have that are deeper in nature than you might have realized when you were 7 or 8. So that can just precipitate a whole crisis. My first book, Story of a Girl, was about kind of both these things. It was that abandonment issue and a crisis of faith in family. The character, so this first book, I set it at my high school, in my town where I went to high school, Pacifica, California. Go Tigers! And I thought about girls that I knew. I remember being in eighth grade, okay? I remember being in eighth grade in Pacifica, and there was a girl in my eighth grade class who would talk about her boyfriend, and it turned out he was like 20 years old. And I was the kind of 13-year-old that was still maybe, I never played with dolls, but I was not the kind of 13-year-old that would have a 20-year-old boyfriend. And I just found this extremely fascinating and strange. And just thinking like, how does that happen? And like, what do her parents think of that? And is that even legal? And what, you know, how does that happen? And then I also thought about girls who, I remember being in high school, and there were always certain girls, and everyone who's ever been in high school, no matter how old you are, I think I can be pretty safe in saying, there's always like at least one girl that has this certain reputation, and there's stories told about her, like she did this sex thing and that sex thing, and she's gross, and like she's easy or nasty or whatever. And these stories would go around, and I don't know that any of us ever stopped to consider whether or not they were true, or what the context was, or if she could tell her side of the story, what would it be? So that's kind of the premise, I guess, of Story of a Girl, is Deanna is a character who, at 13, she has this sexual encounter with a friend of her older brother's. Her dad knows about it, and from that moment kind of can't deal, her dad just can't deal with it and kind of rejects her, and the mom is kind of out of it. And now when the time that the book takes place, she's 16, and this whole experience is coming back to reckon with her, because this friend of her brother's ends up coming in to work at the pizza place that she works at. And it was really interesting when the book came out, kind of reading people's takes on it. Some people saw it as kind of an indictment of double standards that are applied to girls, especially when it comes to sexual behavior. For me, it was always just a family story. I feel like all my books, that's what they are at their heart. And throughout the process of this book, I think Deanna is trying to recover some kind of sense of faith in her family that has kind of let her down. And one thing she's hoping, she's pretty close with her older brother, and one thing she's hoping is that when he and his girlfriend and their baby move out of the house, that she can go with them. So she has this, she harbors this fantasy. And have you read Member of the Wedding by Carson McCullers? I don't know if anyone's read that. For those of you that have read it, like the main character, Frankie, her brother is getting married, and she just thinks that when her brother gets married, she's gonna go with them. I so sympathize with the coughing, because I've had that for the last 4 weeks, so don't feel bad. Let it out. Especially, I gotta find the, because I think I'm gonna read a different section than I thought I was going to, but I think in this scene, it's just a moment, it's pretty short, it's just a moment where it starts to become clear. Not clear. Deanna starts to get a hint that there's some glimmer of hope on the horizon. I don't think you need to know much, except this comes really toward the end of the book. So the family's kind of had their big fight where everything has come out into the open and everyone has expressed their problems. And another thing that's happened in the recent past in the story is her brother's girlfriend, who is a new mom, has kind of freaked out and run off for a couple days to just get a break from the baby. But they're all back together now. And this is like the night after they've had this big family blow up. I was off work that night and didn't know what to expect with Dad and me both home. Mom had left a note for me to put a casserole in the oven, so I did, and set the table for four. Stacy left for her shift, and Darren came home from his. "What are you doing?" he asked, appearing in the kitchen, carrying April in her car seat. He took in the set table, complete with water glasses and cloth napkins. Making dinner?" We looked at each other and both came out with the same nervous laughter. Darren ran his hand through his hair. "Why not? This family's done crazier things than eat dinner together. I'm in." When Mom got home from work and found us there, her tired face lifted. "You kids are both in tonight? That smells wonderful, Deanna." "You made it, Mom. I just put it in the oven." "I can take over from here," she said, setting her purse down and rolling up her sleeves. "It's okay," Darren said. "We got it covered." She smiled. "All right. Maybe I'll put my feet up for a bit." The casserole finished, Darren threw some frozen rolls into the toaster oven, and we waited 15 minutes past the time Dad usually got home from work. "Maybe he's working overtime," Darren said. "They never give him overtime," I said, unwrapping a stick of butter and putting it in the butter dish we hadn't used since Thanksgiving. "Well, I'm starving, so let's get the show on the road." He put April's car seat on a chair so she could watch us eat. I brought everything to the table. Mom came in and sat down, checking her watch. Then we all heard the front door open and close, and he walked in. April flapped her arms. Dad stopped, and I imagined us through his eyes, his family, sitting in a pink kitchen, his tired wife who never complained, his son who looked exactly like him, his daughter who used to be the baby, his baby girl, and now April, his granddaughter, who had a whole life in front of her with no real mistakes in it yet. Could he look at us someday, I wondered, maybe today, and not be disappointed? Could he see us and himself for who we really were? He sat down. Mom dished up the casserole. I passed the butter. April watched us with her big eyes, the Lamberts eating dinner. Before bed, I wandered into the living room to find Mom still up and watching Letterman. You could tell I wrote this in 2005. She smiled at me and held out a bag of microwave popcorn. I sat next to her, taking a big handful. Her legs were stretched out onto the coffee table, stubbly hair all over like she hadn't had time to shave for maybe a week. I'm gonna stay up all night watching TV and then call in sick tomorrow, she said. A commercial came on and I felt Mom's eyes on me. Come here, sweetheart, snuggle up. She held her arm out, smiling. I was embarrassed. I hadn't cuddled with Mom since I was a kid, way before Tommy. But the living room was dark except for the TV, and it was just the two of us. So I leaned toward her and she pulled me in. She smelled like popcorn and the flowery lotion she always used. I curled my legs underneath me, putting my head in her lap. She stroked my hair while we finished up Letterman and the popcorn. Then I closed my eyes, concentrating on the warmth of her fingers on my scalp, the worn chenille of her old robe under my cheek. Tears gathered behind my eyes. I sniffled, hoping Mom wouldn't say anything or ask anything or stop touching my hair. She didn't. I lay there in my mom's lap for I don't know how long, and before I drifted to sleep, I thought of something Lee said once when she was talking about church, that sometimes there was no reason to believe in God and you'd look at your life and know it was crazy to feel peaceful, but you did anyway, and that was faith. I know that having faith in your family isn't the same as God or religion or whatever, but I could kind of get what Lee meant about believing in something when it made more sense not to. Another hilarious moment. So I had this weird, about 5 years into my published writing career, I had a little bit of a meltdown. Like I had written 4 books in 4 years, pretty much. Well, the first book was pretty much done. So let's say 3 books over the course of 4 to 5 years. And I kept waiting to publish a disaster, like a book that just everyone hated and everyone was disappointed in and would get like a 2-star average review on Amazon or whatever. And it just felt like all this pressure that every time I wrote a book, it had to be better than the last one. And I constantly had to live up to this thing of being a National Book Award finalist with my first book and getting good reviews. And I just felt like I just can't do, like I'm tired and I don't know what I want to write about. And I don't know if I want to keep writing. And so I was having this was all happening right around when I turned 40. So I was kind of having like the beginning of my midlife crisis that I think has, I'm 46 now, I think it just ended. maybe 6 months ago. But I had this book under contract, you know, it was like I had been paid the first part of the money and I had to write the book to get the second part of the money. And I just felt like I was performing. So I ended up writing about my midlife crisis in the life of a 16-year-old girl who was a piano prodigy, who quits kind of at the height of her performance career. And that happens toward the beginning of the book. And then the rest of the book is kind of like, is she gonna keep playing piano? And if she is, why is she gonna do it? And how is she gonna do it? Is she doing it for herself or for other people? So this is just another flashback scene where she's playing this piano festival in Prague. Oh, it happens later in the book than I thought. Oh, there it is, okay. So she's at this big piano competition in Prague, and before she left for the competition, her grandmother, who was kind of the person in her family she was closest to, has been sick. And her grandfather is kind of a driving force behind her piano career, and kind of one of the main, her grandfather and her mother, who are father and daughter, are the ones applying the most pressure and just trying to get her to keep up her momentum and keep doing what she's doing. And she considers not going to this festival because she's worried about her grandma, but they kind of all convince her to go. And so she's been at the festival and it's intermission, and her time to play is coming up. And kind of everything Lucy is thinking about piano in this scene is what I was thinking about writing while I wrote this book. She could win this, she realized, listening to the three competitors who went before her. Maybe not the whole thing, but this round of it. And she didn't care. After breakfast, she'd gotten her dad to admit that Grandma Beck wasn't doing quite as well as they'd said, that everything wasn't fine. He claimed not to know the details, though, and repeated Grandpa's advice to focus on her performance. Lucy did her best to put it all out of her mind, and after her shower, got her hair into a complicated updo and went to the concert hall early to warm up on one of the backstage pianos. Her neck finally loosened and her headache was mostly gone. She sat with the other competitors in the front row, stage right. She'd be first up after the intermission. When it came, she stayed in her seat and used the time to think through her piece. Even though she didn't care about winning, she definitely didn't want to embarrass herself in front of all these people. She was Lucy Beck Moreau. She'd do this. Lucy. Upon hearing her father's voice, she snapped out of her pre-playing trance, assuming he'd come down front to wish her luck. "Hey," she said. He crouched in front of her. "I have to tell you something, because I just have to. Grandpa thought we should wait until after, but it's not right. I think you'd hate me." "It's Grandma," she said. Her dad replied, "There's something called sepsis. The pneumonia is bacterial. It's bad." He put one hand on each of her knees. "It mostly happened while we were in flight here. She's been on a ventilator, and that's why we couldn't call her. She's in the ICU." Lucy listened, trying to catch up. "Is she going to be okay?" "Her kidneys have already shut down. Her liver is on its way out, and her heart." People had started to come back in to take their seats. Laughter, conversation. "She's going to die," Lucy said, because he wouldn't. Her father leaned forward as if to hug her. She pushed him away. "No. We were going to tell you today, right after." "Why did you change your mind? Why did you change your mind right now?" Her shock was turning to panic, and she spoke in a shrieky whisper. "I'm supposed to go up there. Why didn't you tell me last night or this morning? What am I supposed to do?" "You don't have to play." "Now you tell me," Lucy thought. "After all these years, now you tell me I don't have to." Then Grandpa Beck was standing there, his eyes blazing. "Of course she has to play. Lucy, your grandmother would want you to." The girl who'd played, and not that well, right before intermission, sat two chairs away and pretended not to be listening and looking. Others were starting to notice, too. "Stefan," her father said, "let's... Dad, it's too late. I can't. I have to just go up." "Good girl," her grandfather said. "Good girl." She heard the words, but the house lights went down, and so she didn't have to see his face. He'd known that morning when he said everything was fine, and he'd known the night before when he said everything was fine. One of the festival workers came out of the wings to remind the audience to silence their phones and that they weren't allowed to take pictures or video. He said it in Czech, English, French, and German. He introduced Lucy. Applause. She stood. The dark blue dress her mother had helped her pick out felt stiff and too young, and she wished she'd worn something else. Her body now operated on momentum. "Climb the stage stairs, go to the piano, sit on the bench, adjust the pedals, because you're on the program." Momentum. Decisions made for her, performances planned a year in advance. "I don't want to go," she told her grandmother. "You have to," her mother had said. She'd been doing what she'd been expected to do all along, working hard, performing well, topping herself, living up. The audience quieted, getting out the last few coughs, holding their program still. Lucy rested her hands in her lap and took deep breaths. All she had to do was play like she always did, just get through it. Then whether she made the next round or not, she could gracefully bow out of the rest of the festival, citing a family emergency, and they would be on their way home. People would feel sorry for her and admire her dedication. Lucy usually kept her eyes straight ahead when playing in public, but this time she turned and stretched until she spotted her grandfather, who always sat where he could see her hands. He nodded once. What kind of heart of stone did it take for him to sit there and not weep? And what was she doing at this piano in front of this audience? Momentum. Great Uncle Kristoff bought a piano at the war, brought a piano and died in the war, and now she didn't get to say goodbye to her grandmother. She looked down at her hands on the keys, and they weren't hers anymore. What she did at the piano didn't belong to her. It hadn't for a long time. It didn't make her feel connected to herself or her family or the audience or the universe. It used to. When had that stopped before this trip, too long ago to remember? She lifted her arms. She could play and avoid a scene, then deal with this in private 20 minutes from now. Not make waves. Or she could make a wave. The audience stirred, impatient. And Lucy stood, scooting the piano bench back. She faced her grandfather and father for a moment so they could see her calm, her certainty. This was not panic, not stage fright, or even shock about her grandma. Nothing but her own decision, her own will, carrying her into the dark wings of the stage. A cluster of festival workers stepped aside as she passed. One said, "Miss Beck Moreau, are you all right?" "Yes." She walked until she found a door, and with no idea where it led, opened it. It took her straight out into an alleyway, the sky bright, the air with a foreign tang. She walked down the alley and out onto the streets of Prague and kept going, getting looks from people who must have wondered what she was doing in that dress, with her hair up and sprayed stiff like an escapee from prom. After a few blocks, she cried, for her grandmother and for herself. Then she saw her surroundings. The city was a miracle of stone and arches, spires and water. Lucy took in the beauty and thought of all the places around the world she'd been without really seeing. There was never any time. What else had she been missing, besides cities, besides school, besides her grandmother's death? What else? What? She didn't have any money on her and didn't know where she was going. Eventually, she got completely lost and her feet killed from walking all day in flimsy flats, and she found a cab to take her back to the hotel. The concierge covered the fare. He knew who he was. After her father alternately hugged her in relief and yelled at her for scaring him, she'd had to face her grandfather, whose expression was impassive when he said, "I take this as your final decision, Lucy. Do not come to me tomorrow and say you changed your mind." And that was the end of that. Momentum stopped. Da 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 da. I don't know if I left as much time as I was supposed to for questions, but now you may ask questions.